It's 2017, praise God. It's going to be a great year with the Lord. It's going to be a great experience. We're going to have victories, and we're going to have some, maybe some streams to cross. We may go through some little fires once in a while this year, but you know what it says in Micah 3:2-13? It says that our Messiah goes before us. He always is going before us. There is nothing that we will walk through this year. There is no challenge that we'll have that our Messiah, our Lord Jesus Christ, will be walking with us and will go before us. Praise God. That's the reason it's going to be a great year. Amen. All right, let's all stand.
Darkness fall, we go singing. unity, but with pretense. Help us realize, let this vision come alive. Let the whole Happy New Year!
Thank you.
just raise everything I am, everything I do.
You say it's all for you.
Yes.
All for you. Man. You know, during the break between Christmas and New Year's, I don't know why I started doing this many years ago, but I used to spend that time of just kind of reorganizing, you know, reorganizing all the receipts and everything from last year, getting it ready for, you know, that day. And reorganizing computer files. And I remember one year just spent that whole time just converting all my CDs to MP3 so I could just get rid of CDs and have it all as MP3s, and organizing my picture files. That's what I did this past couple of weeks. And then going through some of my old music and thumbing through some stuff that I had just sitting there in files for stuff to look at. And I came across this song. It's a David Crowder song. And I don't listen to David Crowder a whole lot, but I like some of his stuff. But this song just really jumped out at me. So it was yesterday. I'm just saying that to give me a little grace in case I blew it. But I love the lyric. And it's simply titled, "You're Everything." You're everything. You're everything I could want. I could need if I could see you want me, could I believe? 'Cause you're perfectly all I. If I could just feel your touch, could I be free? What do you shine so? Can a blind man see? What do you call? Why do you
beckon me? Can the deaf hear the voice of love? Would you have me come? Can the cripple run? Are you the one to raise me up from this grave? Touch my tongue, then I'll sing. Heal my limbs, then joyfully I'll run to you. To raise me up from this grave, and touch my tongue, and then I'll sing. Heal my limbs, then joyfully I'll run to you. You're everything I could want, but I can't believe. And I can just feel your touch, and I can't breathe. Look how you shine so the blind can see. How you call out, you beckon me. The deaf hear the voice of love. You bid me come and the cripple run. No, you're the one to raise me up from this grave. Touch my tongue and then I'll sing. Heal my limbs and joy. Just to sit here at your feet and worship you. stop. Can't live without you, Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough. All this is for you, every hopeless situation ceases to exist. And when you walk into the room, the dead begin to rise, 'cause there is resurrection life in all you do. We love you, we'll never stop. Hearts are yours, we want you. We want you. Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours, we want you. Oh, we want you, Lord. Yes, come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts. Stop. Can't We're making some New Year declarations.
Amen, amen.
More of you, less of me.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
More of you, less of me. Sing a little more of that. More of you, less of me. 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 More of you, more of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. More of you, more of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. More of you, less of me. More of you, more of you, less of me. Less of me. Less of me. Your hand of mercy to heal me. I am weak, and I need your love to free me. Oh Lord, my rock, my strength. Your promise never fails me, and my desire is to follow you forever. For you are good, for you are good, for you are good to me. For your hand of mercy to heal me, and I am weak, and I need your love to free me. Oh Lord, my rock, my strength, in weakness, come rescue me. To follow you forever. For you are good. For you are good. For you are good to me. For you are good.
For you are good. You are so good to me.
For you are good.
For you.
are good.
For you are good.
For you are good to me.
For you are good. For you are good. You are so good to me.
Sing it out. Come on.
For you are good.
And I need your love to free me, oh Lord, my rock, my strength, in weakness, come rescue me, oh Lord, thank you for the promises of your word.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And Father, that all things around us may fade, but your word does not. And your promises are true forever. And that you will not leave us nor forsake us. That you are for us and not against us.
Yes, that's right.
Lord, that you will be faithful to complete that which you've begun in all of us, Father. We thank you for that, Lord. And you have given us every resource, Lord God. You have placed it all inside us. We actually have everything we need resident within us, Lord God. But, Father, that it would be our heart cry that we would decrease so that you may increase, Father. Lord, and we cry out for more. When we cry out for wanting more, we're desperate for you. We're thirsty for you. That, Father, what we really want to see is you taking over, you being in control of us.
Yes.
And, Lord, that you would do that from the inside out. Inside out. And we thank you, Father. Lord, let us start this new year, Lord, that with that as our prayer, with that as our goal, Lord God, that you would transform us from the inside out. More of you, less of us. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Won't you be seated?
Good morning, church family. Happy New Year. Happy I don't have my blinky glasses on like Kathy Williams, but I'm blinking. I thought that was too cool. She said, Linda, if the world can do it, I can do it today. I said, amen. Okay, I just wanted to remind you that next week, we only have one service again. There will be connect groups, I believe, in most of the classes. So a connect group starts at 9:15, but at 10:30... when you walk in here next week, this place is going to be transformed into a, with tables and chairs, into a beautiful banquet hall because we want to honor Marilyn and Clarence on their retirement. Trying to get through this without getting all crying. So here's what we're asking everyone to do. We know how many tables and chairs we can get in here. We're going to put 9 chairs around each table, which will be a little snug, but that's okay. We're going to have tables up there and over here, and we will know the ones that are going to be sitting up here, but we'll have tables and chairs all in here, and then we're going to have to do overflow with just single chairs all the way around the perimeter of the building. So if you come in late, just that's going to be what's going to happen. We'll have our ushers being on top of things to know where people are sitting, and we ask that if you, I think we're to, Are you going to have a sermon next week or just
short? I'm
going to
share something short.
Okay. So I'm just saying that to say that if you have your belongings with you, just know where you're seated, where you put your stuff down. And that way when the ushers, when new people come in, they will know, okay, these tables are taken and nobody will lose their seat, okay? But here's how we're going to do this. We'll go out this door, in through the nursery. All the food will be served over there. Then you'll come out the back door of the nursery and come back in this door into the sanctuary when we get ready to eat next week, okay? Try to make it real simple. In my little head, that's the way it should work, but we'll see. And we'll have your drinks out there. We're going to do bottled water, and we'll do plastic bottle Cokes and Sprite probably. So that's what the drinks will be. It'll be real easy, and hopefully with the caps, we won't do a lot of spilling on the carpet, okay? So that's what we're going to do. We will also have, make sure I'm covering everything. We're going to also ask you parents to do something for us. The nursery is open. So if you have a young one, if you could use the nursery, the ladies in there are ready for them. Also, if you have a child that's 4 years old, I guess, through youth, they need to go upstairs, and they're going to have a pizza party for them next week, so they'll have fun up there. That way, it'll free the sanctuary with seats to have more adults that'll be able to sit down. It's not that we don't think our children love Pastor Clarence and Marilyn, but we just want to try to get as many adults seated as we can. We're going to ask Aaron, he's not here this morning, but he's going to be asking the youth to help serve. So we will get with him, and he'll have a team of his youth that'll serve, and when they get through helping all of us, they can get their food and just take out to the trailers to eat. So that's going to free up a lot of seats. So we're hoping with all of that, we can keep everybody in the building, and everybody will be happy with smiles on their faces. Okay, the other thing is we're going to have at the information table back here, we're going to put a blessing table where if you have a card of encouragement. We will have a tree there for blessing gifts if you want to participate in that. And that will be for the Lees, but that'll be back here. So that's kind of how next Sunday is going to look. So if you have any questions, you guys can call me at the office Tuesday because we won't be open tomorrow. But we're excited that we were able to honor you, even though we're not happy about you leaving. But we're excited for you because we know God has mighty things in store. Thank you very much.
Praise the Lord. Well, I think that 2017 is going to be marked by a walk with the Holy Spirit. I mean, I don't know about you, but you know those books, journals that Pastor Greg passed out here quite a number of months ago. I've been filling mine up. And I realize that I need to hear from God. I don't know about you, but I need to hear. Amen. That means I need to hear words coming from the Holy Spirit. And you know what? He's more than willing to talk to us, right?
Amen.
He is. He is. And when you hear a word from God, you're so excited, you know exactly what you've got to do. So this year, in seeking the Lord, you seek the Holy Spirit of God who's within us 24/7. That's why you want to watch out what you say, how you walk, where you're at. Isn't it great to not have a hangover this morning? Oh, man, I am glad to be in the house of God. Praise the Lord. And I've got a wonderful secret. We have been praying for a special group of people this morning. Guess who they are? Our visitors. If you're here for the first time, stand up, stand up. I met a young man over here. Everyone, this is your first time. We want to recognize you, honor you, give you a special packet. Thank you for being with us. And we believe that this is going to be a special Sunday for you because Brother Greg has got a wonderful word, I know, looking forward into 2017. And if you'll take There's a little card in your packet. If you would take that back to that desk as you exit this morning and give that to them, that gives us information where we can keep you up on things that are going on in this church. We're going to give you a little gift along with that. So we want to try to bless you. God bless you. Let's see. We got.
Oh. Good morning, everyone. So happy to see y'all. Welcome to the house of the living God. And he's living in our hearts and he's here moving within us. So that's so amazing. It is now time to continue our worship. And our worship, that a lot of times we don't think of it that way, but it is. And it's when we bring our tithes and our offerings before the Lord into the storehouse of the Lord. So to, if you need an envelope, please raise your hand at this time. The ushers will come by and bring it to you. If you need a pen, you may want to ask your neighbor, see if they got one to help you out. It's convenient. Get to know them. Hey, we're here to help. We're a body to work with one with another. The other special thing we have is that the Nehemiah challenge is still on today. Today, I believe it may be the final day of it. But we ask one simple thing. If you're going to give for the Nehemiah Project, and I pray that you do, that you consider it, that you go ahead and date it for yesterday. December 31st. If you want the tithe of today to be going into 2016 for the receipt records that Pastor Greg referenced earlier to get us ready for that time of year in April, then put that also for December 31st. That's a great thing to know that there's a difference because today's the first and today's 2017, so we begin 2017. So as you get you ready, your offerings and your tithes and your alms before the Lord today, I have some scripture that I really want to share that the Lord brought about into my heart this morning. And it's found in Isaiah 43, verse 18 and 19. It's amazing because we are entering a new year. So it's a year of new beginnings. The Lord has allowed humans to be able to record time and to be able to differentiate it. And thus we have January 1st, which we call the first of the year. But the Lord says, do not cling to events of the past or dwell on what happened long ago. Watch for the new thing I am going to do. It is happening already. You can see it now. I will make a road through the wilderness and give you streams of water there. So we're here proclaiming the promises of God that today is a day of new beginnings, but it requires us to leave the past and it requires that we let go of what we've had to receive the fresh water that the Lord has for us. Leave that wilderness behind and let's enter to the promised land of the Lord this morning. Father, we come before you. We thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We thank you because we're not just here by accident. You have divinely purposed us for here today for such a time as this, Father. So, Lord, we rise up within you. We gladly bring into the storehouse what you have given unto us already. We want to keep our covenant with you because you are so faithful. You're so amazing. You have covered us through 2016, even when we didn't deserve it. But you kept us here to be able to enter 2017 knowing that you, through the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, yes, are about to break out in the Freedom, yes, Center, even at a greater level for each and our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen.
What's going on? One that you want to listen to.
Good morning, church, and Happy New Year from the Freedom Center Church family to you. I'm standing inside of our new building. This is where the sanctuary is going to be. There's going to be chairs here. The stage is going to be up there. It's going to be awesome. New Year, new building. So every time you guys drive by or think of the church, make sure you're praying for it and just believing for God's favor for this year for this building. So next Sunday, we have one service at 10:30 a.m. to celebrate the retirement of our associate pastors, Clarence and Marilyn Lee. So come at 10:30, no 8 o'clock service. We're going to have food, so come hungry. It's going to be awesome. We're going to eat, we're going to party, we're going to celebrate them, and it's going to be good. So one service next week, come hungry. Men's prayer is coming up this Friday, January 6th at 6 a.m. So all you guys out there, I know it's kind of early, but just set your alarm. It's going to be good food and good fellowship on our men's prayer at Kelly's Country Cookin'. Can't say it enough. Kelly's Country Cookin'. Tongue twister and try saying it 3 times fast. Go. Kelly's Country Cookin'. All right, no, guys. But make sure you're setting your alarm to be there at 6 a.m. It's going to be awesome, a great time of fellowship. And that's all I have for you guys this week. Make sure you make it a great week. It's the first week of the year. I know. This is so exciting. You started off with Sunday at church. Well done. Thank you all for being here. Have a great week, church.
to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. And I will sing again. I will sing again.
Sing that first verse again.
You are so good to me. My broken heart, you are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me. You, my broken heart, you are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song.
So good to me, you heal my
Father in heaven, you are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again. I will sing again. And I will sing again. Sing again.
was trying to remember the guy's name, the evangelist that does all the street evangelism. And his name's escaping me. I thought, well, we don't have to be ignorant. I could use my phone, but even with my phone, I'm still ignorant. I couldn't find it. But we've watched some of his stuff, and he has a clip. You know, he evangelizes. He'll use the Ten Commandments. And Ray Comfort, thank you. Boy, I couldn't pull that name out. Ray Comfort. And there's one scene where he's going like through a mall, and he's questioning young people if they can name the Ten Commandments. And none of them hardly could do it at all. You know, about the only one they can all come up with, you're not supposed to kill nobody, you know. That's the only one they can come up with, right? And even that one gets misinterpreted. We won't go there today, but that one even gets misconstrued. But they couldn't name the Ten Commandments. And then he asked them, okay, will you name 10 beers? Oh, my goodness. They named probably 50. Just, ah, da, 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 right? And that's a shame. That's a shame. Because today, what our word is about is saturated by the word. Amen. Saturated by the word. Our text is 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. I'll give you a minute to turn there. It was the first scripture they showed. I love that picture there. The scripture's just coming out and embracing her. Smothering her. Saturating her. This is an important message, and I'm so thankful. We've got an awesome church. You know, really through the holidays, having church on Christmas Day, having church on New Year's Day, and I'm like, Lord, will anybody show up? And y'all amaze me. You're awesome. I brag on you all the time. This is an awesome church. Love you guys. Thank you. Just take a moment to say thank you for all your many blessings to the pastoral staff, all of our staff. Thank you so much. All the cards and all the gifts. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Blessing. 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching. Our message today is to regroup us for the new year. We're hitting a reset button today in our efforts to read the Word. I asked you last year about this time to read the Bible through. I'm not going to ask if you did or you did not. That is not the point. The point is, did you make an effort? That's the point. And if you did not complete it, don't beat yourself down. Keep going. Keep going. Press through. If you did it, do it again. Do it again. I know somebody who's read the Bible through 5 times last year. Yeah. And you know what? That doesn't just have to be you sitting there reading it either. You know what? That particular person, I've met with them before, and they're waiting on me, and I show up, and they've got earphones on, and they've got the word being read to them, and they're sitting there with the journal taking notes and writing thoughts. I don't care how you get it. Get it. Get it and keep getting it. And try to find all the time that you can. Use your time. We need more than 15 minutes a day. We need more than 45 minutes a day. We need it all day long. All day long. Whether that's reading it, whether that's listening to it, or meditating upon it. I don't care what action you're involved in, but it needs to be all through your day. From the time you are conscious and you wake up to the time you lay your head down in the bed, you need to be into the Word. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm not talking about legalism here. I'm talking about life, living, kingdom living. This is kingdom living. All scriptures inspired by God, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, your word might say complete, equipped for every good work. How many of you need to be equipped for good works? Hello? So reset that button. And there's a reason why we need to do this, because we don't need some word. We don't need a little word. We need a bunch of the word. Bunches of it. Continually. We need the word to make it through this assignment on the earth and to do the things that we've been called to do and that we've been purposed to do while living on this earth. So reset the button for the word. I'm going to explain some things how, because what you need is a hunger and an appetite for it. And I'm going to give you a simple way to get an appetite for the word of God. Okay? Not yet. There's nothing magical about Scripture. That's not what it's about. Paul wrote that all Scripture is inspired by God. Guys, just let that soak in. All Scripture is inspired by God. He means it's literally God-breathed, God-inspired. The best way I can explain that to you, as a songwriter, I've spent my whole adult life, actually probably the first song I wrote, I might have been somewhere between 13 and 15. I don't remember. And what partly was, I was in youth choir, and we sang this song, and it was a pretty good song. I liked it. Everybody liked it in youth choir, and I made a comment to a choir director. I said, it's a great song, but it's too short. It's like, it needs another verse. And she just looked at me and said, well, write another one. Oh. So I went home. I sat down on my bed, and I wrote another verse. Came back, and it worked out. It was pretty good. And so all of a sudden, I was a little interested in songwriting. And a lot of my songs, especially early on, there's a lot of bad ones. There's some good ones. But you know what? I had to learn a craft of writing. There's a craft to writing. You prepare yourself for those moments of inspiration where it just gets dumped on you. But you continually build the craft. You develop it. And how do you do that? By writing. By writing and then evaluating, analyzing it, listening to others, comparing, getting advice, getting constructive criticism. You develop a craft. Now, I've written a lot of songs that I would not say were a divine moment. I've literally written some songs where I just woke up that day and I said, today I'm going to write two songs. And I go to the piano with the determination to write two songs. And I remember one particular time I wrote two songs, and guess what? They turned out pretty good. They were good. You've sung them before. We haven't sung them in a while, but those particular songs, when I first came here, we sang them a bunch. They were good songs. I've sung them with many congregations through the years. Good songs. They came through labor. They came through crafting it, right? But I've had some songs that I'm sitting there driving down the highway, and all of a sudden, and I have to pull over to the side of the road, and all I am doing is dictating it. And that song pours out melody and lyrics in about as long as it takes to sing the song. It just comes out. Not really much craft. I think God uses the preparation of the craft to help it come out and come out in a beautiful way. But nonetheless, the inspiration, the thought, and the content was being dumped on me. It was being downloaded from heaven. All I was a hand holding a pen, writing lyrics on a piece of paper, and then went to a place where I could record it to take that melody that had been downloaded onto me so that I could record it so that we could remember it so we might sing it again. And again. And again. And again. See, that's God inspired. And that's what the Lord God did with Scripture. He took these human vessels that had put themselves in a place to receive. They had prepared themselves, and they were in a place to receive, and God downloaded upon them. And their hand, the only thing that was involved in that process was their hand holding the pen. And God downloads the content and puts it on paper. And they record it so that we might read it again and again and again. Guys, do y'all understand that? That's a powerful thought. God inspired. God writing His words on paper for us to walk through this world. Scripture was inspired by God, meaning the content did not come from men. He just used their hands to stroke the pen across the paper, but the content was downloaded by God. So we find the scripture is legitimately the thoughts in the heart of God being communicated through the form of written media to his people. That's what it is. And down through scripture, God tells his people over and over and over and over again, meditate on these words. Meditate on these words. Know these words. Live by these words. When we read the Bible through this past year, one of the things that just jumped out at me, I'd never seen before. Before the Israelites go across the River Jordan and God's talking to Moses. Moses has not even died yet, but he's about to. And God's given him some final instructions. And he's telling him that when they get over there, it's so crazy. It's not crazy. This is the way God is. He already knows, right? He said before they even go over there, he said that when they get over there, they're going to want to be like everybody else. And they're going to want to have a king. And what that king needs to do, I'd never seen this before. That king needs to get with the priest and he needs to write down his own copy of the word. He has to write down his own copy of the word. Why? So that he will know it intimately and he will meditate on it and he will be familiar with it so he would not stray from the commandments of God, so that he would know how to govern the people in a godly and righteous way. Scripture. It's for us to live by. This is a critical point because a lot of people have a lot of opinions of what this is. But it is the very heart, the thoughts, the values of God Almighty that we're to live by. His values. I've said that to my own children when they get out of line. I want you to live by my values. My values. You're walking around with my name. You're going to live with my values. The Word of God is inspired, downloaded, a written media that could be reread and reread and reread. And from that scripture, God's telling us in this particular passage that we read, he says that there are wise precepts for godly living within these scriptures. Wise precepts for godly living, whereby we teach one another. I'm teaching you right now. Families on the go, we teach one another. Bible connections, teaching one another. Home groups, teaching one another. Even when we have things that seem a little bit more laid back, like our men's prayer, when they get into groups, they're still teaching one another with the word. Because when somebody lays out a problem that they're going through in life, somebody else encourages them with the word. And when you're encouraging somebody with the word, you're teaching them the precepts of God. You're saying, this is what God says, and this is what you need to do in that situation in your life. That's what the Word of God is for. It's what it does. Number two, he said, because there's teaching for right living, it also offers reproof or rebuke. Everybody say, ouch. Ouch. For when we mess up, it judges us. And it rightly judges us. Be thankful that it does. Because here's the beautiful thing. What's next? What Paul was saying, not only does it judge us or rebuke our mistakes, but it also offers correction. Now that word is a positive word. That word, I think when we read that, we think of correction as in the spanking. No, that's the rebuke. The correction is where God now speaks to us and he restores us. That's correction. Because the Bible not only rebukes us or judges us, but it also tells us how to get right. It corrects us. Man, that's good. That's a positive word, meaning it shows us how to be restored. It shows us how to right wrongs. It shows us how to heal wounds. It shows us how to correct the direction of our living and choices. And then it also said it trains us for righteousness. Trains us for righteousness. I want you to key on that word train. That's what the Lord kind of brought me, that word train. Because I want you to broaden your mind on training. Because we live in this kind of perfectionist world when we think of training as if when we're being trained that we don't make mistakes. No, part of training is making mistakes. Yeah, here's the illustration. Forgive me. I'm sorry. I'm going to go here. I'm a product of the 70s. I used to love that TV show Kung Fu. David Carradine. Little Grasshopper, right? I loved that show. Watch, I probably watched every episode. I don't think it ran for 2 years. In my mind, it was successful, but I don't think it was. But nonetheless, you remember the show, right? Those of you in my age bracket. Kung Fu, David Carradine, Little Grasshopper. And Little Grasshopper was always being taught by his mentor, by his master. In most cases, when you watched it, it would begin, the episode would begin with Little Grasshopper being taught something by his master, by his mentor. And inevitably, about every episode, in that moment of being trained or being taught, he failed. He failed. But in his failure, he was corrected of how to do it right. Preparing him, growing him up. Training doesn't mean you never fail, but it means that failure doesn't stop anything. You get up and you learn from it and you move forward. We are in training, and the word is essential to our training. The word of God is essential to your training. Paul said that within this process of daily living out the word in our lives, it makes us complete. We will be adequate, meaning we are up for the job. That's what it means. Are you up for the job of living in this earth? Are you up for the job for your purpose and your calling that God's called you for in this earth? Are you up for the job? Within these scriptures contains the means to be up for the job, the training to be up for the job. There are a lot of Christians who aren't feeling up for the job. But when we truthfully examine our devotional life, we typically find that the training is not taking place to make us up for the job. There's not a hunger. There's not a pursuit of the word. And therefore, you fight battles against spiritual principalities with no strength, no training, no stamina, lacking ability. Your defense is fine for the war because you're covered by the blood of Jesus, but your offense is anemic for the battles in the war. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm going to read it one more time. Your defense is fine for the war, meaning you're covered by the blood, but your offense is anemic for the battles in the war. You don't want to fight battles anemic. I hate to go here again. Best example I could come up with. I've watched them all year long. The Texans. Can't blame the defense. Can't blame the defense. Even missing their star player, they've showed up and showed out. They've made so many games winnable. But the offense has been anemic. And you can't just blame it on Osweiler. I'm sorry. There's a whole lot more to it. How can you be vigorous and have vitality and strength and be effective in the battlefield when your game plan is run, run, pass, punt. 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 Whoa, pass. Run, pass, punt. Run, run, pass, punt. Run, run, pass, punt. You don't need much of a game plan for the defensive team to go against that. You know exactly what they're going to do every down. Hello. Hello, my brothers in Christ, my sisters in Christ. What's your game plan look like in the earth? Are you running, running, passing, punt, running, running, passing, punt, running, running, passing, punt, running, running, passing, punt? Oh, wait a minute. Pass, run, pass, punt. Ah. I think you know what I mean. For those of you who've lived through it this season, you know exactly what I mean. Your anemic condition can only be remedied by a hearty appetite for the word of God in your life. You know, if you find yourself making the same mistakes over and over and over and over, while the word offers a different thought or a different action or a different result, you're going to get the same outcome and the same outcome and the same outcome until you come up with a different plan. I'll say it again. Your anemic condition is remedied by a hearty appetite for the Word of God in your life. I just gave you the answer for thirst. Here's how simple it is. It's funny how the natural can teach us things in the spiritual. I do love to eat. Go ahead and laugh at me. Used to, I was known for my eating. I was. When I got through, we'd go to the like Ryan Steakhouse and places like that, buddy, I load up. And then when I go to the dessert bar, I get the big dinner plate to go to the dessert bar. That's what I did. I loaded up, brother. I ate and I ate. I came out feeling good. And it didn't pile on me. Now it piles on me. You know, I'm having to watch it. And I know a few folks who don't eat too much. They don't eat so much. They don't have a hearty appetite. And here's the truth. I wasn't born with that hearty appetite. I cultivated that hearty appetite. I did. If you want a hearty appetite like me, then start eating. If you want a hearty appetite like me, then start eating. Stretch your gut. See, I knew y'all. I wrote on there somewhere in here. I know you're laughing at me. This is true. This is true. If you want a hearty appetite, then start eating. If you want a hearty appetite, then start eating. Stretch your gut. Build up a hearty appetite for the Word. Absorb the saturated fat. Hallelujah. Woo! I've had to rebuke my wife so much during the holidays. No, honey, no! It's the holidays. I want my saturated fat. Yeah. Well, you start absorbing the saturated fat of the living Word of God and get large, increase, expand. That's what it does. Here it is. I'll read it. We laugh because we know what consuming food does in the natural. But you are released to gorge in the Word. You are released to gorge in the Word. There must be appetite. Psalm 63, 1 through 6 says this, O God, you are my God. I shall seek you earnestly. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you. Thirsting and yearning. That yearning is a hunger. I got a grill for Christmas, and I'm firing it up this afternoon. I don't care if it's raining. I'm firing up my grill because after next Sunday, I won't get to use it for 21 days. But I've already got pork tenderloin, venison tenderloin, sausage, hamburgers, steaks, you name it. We're grilling it. And my flesh yearns for that. It yearns for it. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Thus I've seen you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory because your loving kindness is better than life. My lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. Listen, listen. My soul is satisfied with the marrow and the fatness. Eat all the saturated fat you want to. And my mouth offers praises with joyful lips. When I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches. I used to use that passage to excuse why I stayed up so late. But when he's talking about the night watches, he really wasn't talking about staying up late and watching TV and or staying up late and writing a song, which that's still good. That's not exactly what was happening there. He was in the wilderness. Why was he in the wilderness? Because there was a posse after him to kill him. There was a hit out on him. And he had escaped to the wilderness. And even in the wilderness, with his life on the line and people out hunting him out to kill him, even in that mess, he could say, even in the night watch, in a place where he probably didn't sleep, the same place twice, because he had to move around because they were after him. But even under that tension and under that kind of environment, he could say, I meditate on your word, even in the night watches. Look what it does. It calms him. It brings healing to his soul. It brings peace to his soul, even when things around him are not going his way and it's a mess. You see what the word does? It satisfies. It satisfies, even in the midst of the mess. It satisfies. The word of God is sustaining and satisfying. When you are living in the saturated fat of God's word, the soul is good. You ever sat down to a good meal? And maybe you ate some things that weren't on the diet. But you step back and you say, it might not be good for me, but it was sure good for my soul. The saturated fat of the Lord is good for the soul. Good for the soul. The word really does complete us. It prepares us for all situations and all events in our life. I've kind of made my first point without telling you, but our first point was this. When we get into the word, we are drawing near to God. When we get into the word, we are drawing near to God. We are drawing near to his thoughts. We are drawing near to his opinions. We're drawing near to his ways. We're drawing near to his moral values. Listen to this little trail through the New Testament. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. 1 John 1:1, what was from the beginning? What we have heard and what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. Revelations 19:11-13. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written on him which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Hello, guys. When you get into the Word, you are drawing near to God. Jesus, the incarnate Word, God with us, who's called the Word of God. When you are saturating yourself with the Word, you are in fact drawing close to his thoughts, his ways, his decrees, the decrees of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That's what that passage in Revelations 19 goes on to call him, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, also known as the Word of God. Here's the second thing. The Word instills his values in us. His word instills his values in us. Psalms 119:11 says, your word I have treasured in my heart that I may not sin against you. Your word I have treasured in my heart that I may not sin against you. Now the key word there is treasured. Because it don't happen by osmosis. I wished it did. It's not like the movie Matrix, where you got some port in the back of your head where we can just plug a cable up there and just download the scriptures into your head. I wished it worked that way, although I don't think I want another orifice. got enough right here, you know. It's not going to, by osmosis, leak from your Bible on the nightstand. into your head while you're sleeping in the bed. I wished it did. I wished it worked that way. But it doesn't. There's only one way that it works. You must dive in. Not only do you dive in, but you must cling to and hold tightly to it. That word treasure is an action word. It's a verb. It means that you take his precepts and his values and you make them your own. Just as if it were gold, as if it were fine treasure, you hide those values in your heart. You guard them and you protect them in your heart. And when it says hide them, it doesn't imply that these values will not be seen, but they actually will be evident. It's more like an investment. You are investing those values into your heart, and those values are going to yield interest in your life. It's going to have a return. You've stored them in your heart. You've deposited them in the bank account of your heart, and the result that is it produces successful living. It yields power into your life. When you deposit his word and you maintain that account with continual deposits as you grow your heart with his word. Holy Spirit uses that word. He uses it. He recalls it. He reminds you. He guides you with it. Just like Psalms 119, 105 says, the word is a light unto my path. It guides me. It directs me. It illuminates my path. Holy Spirit does the illuminating with the word. I'll close with this. There is not much in this world that will last. Amen? This world will fade. Fame is fleeting. Wealth is fleeting. Beauty is fleeting. Sorry. Days themselves are fleeting. But not the word of God. Isaiah 48 says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever, forever, forever. You know that nothing around you will last but the word of God. If you knew that nothing around you will last but the word of God, wouldn't it seem wise that the consuming of his word would be the one thing of utmost priority in your life? Some people think the world's falling apart, and it may be. But if it's falling apart, isn't it crazy to think that our reaction would be to buy gold and silver and a bunch of food so that we might survive rather than to fill ourselves and saturate ourselves with the word of God? Paul was living in a world that looked like it was falling apart too. He wasn't buying things. He was spending time before the throne. He was being saturated with the word of God. He didn't need gold or silver or survival food supplies. Paul desired the word of God above all else. That's why he wrote, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the men of God may be adequate, complete, prepared, gamed up, equipped for every good work. His end time solution wasn't gold or food. It was to be equipped by the word, protected by the word. The word of God is rigged out for you. I was coming home from vacation last summer. I think we finally had gotten into Texas and needed some gas, pulled in to fill up. This four-door Jeep pulls up. I love four-door Jeeps. I think they're cool. This one had big old tires on it, had that military kind of khaki color. He goes inside, and I'm sitting there looking at his Jeep, and I'm thinking, but it looks unusual. There wasn't, you could tell it was brand new, but it didn't look brand new by the paint. It was textured. It didn't have a shine whatsoever. And so I'm really curious. I go over there, and I kind of mess with it. It ain't metal. And then he comes out, and I said, dude, what kind of body is that? I mean, that's a weird paint job. He goes, that's Kevlar. Ooh. I said, you're preparing for something. That's bulletproof. His Jeep was bulletproof. Bulletproof. God's given us the word of God. He's rigged us up with bulletproof protection. He's outfitted us for rough, hostile terrain. It prepares us. It trains us so that we might be gamed up and adequate and ready and prepared for for that journey, equipped for every good work. Amen. Everybody stand. Amen. Father, we worship you today. We thank you, Lord, for this day, this new year. And Lord, as we close today, I would just want to extend an invitation to anybody today, you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, that you would cry out to him, call out to him. And if you came with a family member, man, ask them, talk to them. If you need somebody to talk to you up front, we all have people up here up front to talk to you. But it's not a difficult thing. It really is coming into agreement with his word that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus did go to the cross and die for your sins, that Jesus really did was buried and rose again from the grave and defeated death and hell, and that he really did ascend to the right hand of the Father, that he really is the King of kings and the Lord of lords, that his blood was poured out and shed for your behalf, that your sin, then we are all sinners, had you on a path to hell, but his blood can redeem you, correct you, correct your path, and put you on a path to heaven, put you on a path to him. And it's by simply just confessing, Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I am a sinner, and I am in need of a Savior. And I ask you, Lord Jesus, to come into my life. I ask you to forgive me of my sins, and I ask for your Holy Spirit to fill me and to inhabit me and to teach me and to train me and be my Lord, be my Savior. I give you my life today. In Jesus' name, it's that simple. If you prayed that prayer, I ask you to either come forward in a moment when we begin to pray as we close and share that, or share that with a family member. But, man, don't leave this place without settling that in your life. And Father, that, Lord, as we leave this place, that, Lord, that we would just be encouraged, that there would be a reset for a hunger and a thirst for your word. And maybe there's some that are sitting here today that have been in dry places. And Lord, they've been sitting in it so long, they don't even know they're thirsty. But Lord God, they'd just go to the well and start drinking the water. And they'd start feasting on the word. And Lord God, that they would develop an appetite by eating. They would begin to eat. Lord, that they would stretch that spiritual gut. Lord God, they would build a desire and a hunger, a yearning and a thirst. Lord God, that they'd realize that everything they need for life completes them through this word. And that they need it. Reset our button, our hunger, our thirst, our desire, our commitment to your word. And Lord, that we won't be beat down with guilt for what we haven't done or not measuring up. It's just going to be a simple resolve that we are going to do it. That we are going to do it. And Lord, that in that process, you're going to train us. You're our mentor. You're our Lord. You're our King. You're our teacher. You're our rabbi. Lord, teach us. Teach us, train us, train us. Thank you, Lord God. I pray, Father, we'll begin to open our minds to creative ways in which we can use our time. We have cell phones, we have iPads, we have all kinds of devices, Lord God, where the word is just readily available at the push of a button, Lord, that we would put it on our computer screens, that we would put it on our phones, that we would saturate ourselves with the word of God. And thank you, Father, Lord, that your word has become so easily accessible. Lord, and what the enemy has used technology for bad, we're going to use technology for good, Lord God. And Lord, use it to saturate our heart, to expand us, to grow us with your word. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this new year. Speak blessings on all of our church family, those that are here, those that might be watching by streaming. Blessings on you, and Father, may it be a wonderful, prosperous, awesome new year, Father, as we move forward into your destiny and your calling upon our lives. And Lord, as we do that, that we will be committed to your word and committed to prayer as we are soon approaching that fast, Lord God, that you'll reset that in our life as well as we begin this new year. We praise you, we thank you, in Jesus' precious holy name, amen. Amen. If you need prayer, we have some folks, prayer teams, if y'all come forward and just spend some time here before we leave. If anybody needs prayer, prayer for breakthrough, prayer for healing, anything you might need prayer for.